this case was never about Aaron Hernandez. This case was about two victims who were stalked, ambushed, and senselessly murdered on the streets of the city they called home.
Well, as you heard, it was first on Fox. Former New England Patriot Aaron Hernandez now accused of killing three people. Hi, everybody. Maria Stefanos.
And I'm Mark Ockblum. We've got team coverage of Hernandez's indictment in a 2012 Boston double murder. Fox 25's Ted Daniel broke this story today and joins us now from our Beacon Hill studio. Ted, hello.
Mark, Maria, after meeting for nearly 11 months behind closed doors, a Suffolk County grand jury returned the indictment this morning. Hernandez first became a suspect in the Boston drive-by after the murder of Odin Lloyd in North Attleboro. Hernandez knew Lloyd, but in the Boston case, authorities say the victims were strangers, gunned down after a chance encounter. The 2012-2013 NFL season, one of the best for Aaron Hernandez, a new $40 million contract, 10 touchdowns. The former Patriot was living large right after authorities say he murdered Daniel DeAbreu and Safira Furtado in cold blood.
Mr. DeAbreu and Mr. Furtado were ambushed and executed as they drove home along Chaumont Avenue in Boston's South End.
Boston police detectives first connected Hernandez to the gangland-style drive-by in June 2013. And from there, the cold case got hot. Police found the murder weapon in a car linked to one of Hernandez's relatives. The SUV, witnesses say the shots came from, that was discovered hidden at the home of Hernandez's uncle in Bristol, Connecticut. Detectives examined surveillance video from in and around Cure Lounge, where DeAbreu, Furtado, and three friends had been partying. It allegedly shows Hernandez slowly circling the block in his SUV and then trailing the men as they left.
Our investigation has not uncovered any evidence that these several individuals were known to each other, but their chance encounter inside the club triggered a series of events that culminated in these murders.
Authorities will not say what happened during that chance encounter at the club, or why Aaron Hernandez, a football star, would target strangers like a street thug.
All the time when we have shootings in the city, everyone right away thinks of gang activity. These were two young, innocent victims who I'm sure loved ones can never go on a day thinking about them.
So Hernandez's cousin, Tanya Singleton, has also been indicted in connection with this case. Prosecutors say she refused to testify before the grand jury. A new arraignment date for Hernandez has not been set. He'll likely face trial in Bristol County for the Lloyd murder before he's brought to Boston to face charges here. I'm Ted Daniel, Fox 25 News.
All right, Ted, thank you.
Right now, the families of Daniel DeAbreu and Safira Furtado are holding a news conference.
Right, Attorney Bill Kennedy represents the family members. Let's listen live. This is Quincy.
Cut down in really the prime of their life. They were very close friends. They were the best of friends. They had gone to school in Cape Verde together. They had been in the service in Cape Verde together. They had worked together in Cape Verde. And although Danny Abreu had come here some 6 years or so before his death, and Safira had only been here for perhaps 7 months, that bond of friendship was there. And they continued, obviously, they were working together at the time of their deaths. Very modest, by the way. They were working as cleaners. They were trying to move on. Danny wanted to be a police officer, as he had been in Cape Verde. Safira wanted to use his languages that he had developed in Cape Verde. The family, obviously, was devastated by the deaths of these two young men. The family decided that they should be buried together. And here is a picture of the tombstones where they are buried over at the Mount Hope Cemetery in Mattapan. The families felt that it was appropriate that these two best friends that were killed together should be buried together. You know, I don't know that there's anything that we can add other than the special people that both Danny Abreu and Safiro Furtado were. You know, they were the kind of people that, you know, I know I heard Safiro would make an effort to make sure that all the members of his family he had some contact with, and that maybe some of them didn't always get along, but he had contact with them. Danny was the type of person that would visit the children of his sister, who was a single parent, and make sure that her three young girls had maybe candy or ice cream and maybe just some attention. You know, I'm not sure that you would consider them heroes. They were heroes to these families. And their deaths mattered. They mattered to the family, and we're pleased that after a long process, it appears that the district attorney has reached his conclusion. The grand jury has reached their conclusion with regard to the results that have been made. We understand that we're involved in a civil matter, which has really little to do with the criminal matter. They're really separate matters. The family, of course, will cooperate in any way that they can in the criminal matters, but those are two separate matters. So I think on behalf of the families, what we wanted to say tonight was thank you for all of the work, the hard work of the district attorney's office, all of the hard work of the police department, and they're very pleased that the justice is being moved forward.
Can you say whether this started over a spilled drink? We've been told that.
I don't think we have any information on that. I heard District Attorney Conley say that there was some type of encounter and that there may be further details. You know, our information, of course, is limited. Presumably there are other sources that may exist, you know, to elaborate. We don't have anything on that.
Can neither of the two fathers maybe say something to us, even if it's in limited English? Us come here to this country as immigrants as well, can understand. Can you say something how you feel today about the indictments on the crime? Puede decir algo sobre lo que pasó hoy?
Está agradecendo a toda a equipa, principalmente Tony, agradecendo toda a polícia, da Boston Police, toda everything the people que me ajudou lá a resolver o problema. Thank you.
Is there a feeling at all that justice, as you mentioned, you have the civil case, but with these indictments, you'll get your day in court?
I'm not sure that. Well, I don't. You want them to answer that question, I suppose. We understand that there's separate processes. We're intending to move forward in our process, but the family is certainly gratified that the district attorney, after a careful investigation, the grand jury, after careful deliberations, undoubtedly has reached the conclusion that these two young men were gunned down for. You know, no reason, no good reason. You know, we also heard and we were aware of that there were rumors or there were statements in the media that these young men and their friends that night, there were five guys that went out to have a few drinks and maybe dance with a couple of pretty girls, and they ended up getting gunned down, that they were members of some type of Cape Verdean gang, or they're involved in drugs, or they're involved in guns. Nothing could be further from the truth. As I believe District Attorney Conley stated, the reality of it is that these young men had nothing at all to do with any of that. They were just out on a night to enjoy themselves and on their way home after really not being there very long, probably no more than an hour or two, ambushed and executed by somebody who had a lot more going for him, you would think.
You said they served together at the Cape Verde. What did you mean by that? When it's in the military?
In the military, yeah. They have
a little bit about that, what kind of work they did, how long they were in the military, anything you can tell us about that?
I know that they served, that's all. I don't know really what the nature of it is.
Can the parents tell us about that? Can the fathers tell us about the military?
They're wrapping up.
And you have been watching a live press conference that's taking place in Quincy at Attorney Bill Kennedy. His office is today. Of course, he represents the families here involved in this double homicide that took place back in 2012. And Aaron Hernandez today indicted for murder in that case. Daniel Abreu, Safiro Furtado put a little history as far as their backgrounds. They were best of friends. They came here from Cape Verde. Daniel came 6 years ahead of Safiro Furtado, who came and within the last 6 months prior to his death. As you can imagine, says that the families are devastated here. Said these were very, very close friends. Very good people. They were so close, in fact, the families decided it was appropriate that they be buried together, and they are at the Mount Hope Cemetery. He also said that the families wanted to make it clear their deaths mattered, and that is a quote. Again, wanted to thank as well today the hard work of the Suffolk County DA's office, also the Boston Police Department, and we'll have much more on this story coming up throughout our newscast today and tonight.
So Fox 25, the only station to speak with an eyewitness to the murders who identified Aaron Hernandez as the killer, and he's a man who was actually right there that night and who first told his story to Fox Undercover's Mike Beaudet last year. Mike is here with more. Mike.
This is a chilling story, an eyewitness account we first brought you last year. The man who was in the car with the murder victims told us Aaron Hernandez pulled the trigger, and now District Attorney Dan Connolly agrees.
These indictments reflect shots fired at three surviving victims who were in the automobile with Mr. Abreu and Mr. Furtado. Those victims are one man who was struck but not killed.
The man struck but not killed is this man, a man who showed Fox Undercover his bullet scars last year and told us months ago what District Attorney Dan Connolly is now confirming, that Aaron Hernandez allegedly killed two of his good friends after a night out at Cure Lounge in Boston's Theater District. He didn't want us showing his face or saying his name, but the man's words are as powerful now as they were then. They just came up and started firing for no reason at all. D.A. Connolly now says Hernandez and another person entered the club at the same time as the victims, and there was some sort of chance encounter inside, triggering a series of events that culminated in the murders. The shooting survivor told us last year, "We never had any trouble. We were not those kind of people. We were just having fun. They left at 2 a.m. when the club closed." The five men were on their way home, stopped here at a red light on Chaminade Ave, about to turn left. The shooting survivor says suddenly an SUV pulled up beside them. He says he heard someone shout, "What up, Negroes?" and then the bullets started flying. Danny was driving. Safira was in the passenger seat. The shooting survivor was in the back seat, right in the middle of his other two friends. Things happened so fast, I was trying to defend myself. They were shooting everywhere inside the car, front to back. They just came to kill. That's it. It wasn't until after Hernandez was arrested for the murder of Odin Lloyd that this man made the connection. He's never been a football fan, but he recognized Hernandez's face. "When I see his face, I just recognize his face. Compare his face that night to his face now. It's that face that I remember." And last year, the witness told me he didn't understand why it was taking so long for Aaron Hernandez to be charged with the murders. After Hernandez was indicted, he declined to talk about these developments. I'm Mike Beaudet for Fox Undercover.
Mike, thank you. If the allegations are true, Aaron Hernandez played an entire season with the New England Patriots after he murdered two people. Fox 25's Brendan Fitzgerald is in Foxborough tonight with that side of the story. Brendan.
Hi, Mark. Well, the Patriots obviously want to put Aaron Hernandez in the rearview mirror, but the events of today shine new light on a player the Patriots thought would be an important and major part of this team for years to come. There were, of course, red flags in regards to Aaron Hernandez before he was drafted by the Patriots in 2010, but never any criminal activity on his record from his time at the University of Florida. The Patriots took a chance and after two seasons were convinced enough to give him a big contract. As we look at things that happened today, it may be worse than it already seemed. Let's take a look at the timeline of that double murder from the summer of 2012. The murder happened on July 16th, and just 9 days after that is when Aaron Hernandez reported to Patriots training camp as they opened things for the season that year. It was 42 days after that double murder that Hernandez and the Patriots agreed to that five-year, $40 million contract extension, which is, of course, when so many were fooled on what the Patriots were getting, including owner Robert Kraft, especially after the $50,000 donation Hernandez made after signing his contract to the Myra Kraft Foundation.
Actually, we're excited that we have him long-term under contract. I said, Aaron, you don't have to do that. You already have your contract. And he said, I want to do it, and it makes me feel good. So thank you very much, Aaron, and thank you for understanding our mission.
He didn't need to give me the amount he gave me, and knowing he thinks I deserve that, and he trusts me to make the right decisions, it means a lot. You know there's a good chance you're set for life as long as you handle it the right way. It's an honor, and it seemed so surreal. Like, is it really true? I have a lot more to give back, and all I could do is play my heart out for them, make the right decisions, and live like a Patriot.
And of course, Hernandez played that season for the Patriots. If you remember, he sprained his ankle early in the season against the Cardinals, but he did play 10 games. He caught 51 balls and had 5 touchdowns. The Patriots ended that season by losing in the AFC Championship game to the Ravens. Obviously, we've learned much more about Aaron Hernandez since those events in the summer of 2012. The Patriots quick to cut him last year after he was arrested, but it is a stain that is not quickly or easily going away. Live in Foxborough, I'm Brendan Fitzgerald, Fox 25 Sports.
Brendan, thank you. Remember to stay with Fox 25 on air and on myfoxboston.com for the very latest on the new indictments handed up today against former New England Patriot Aaron Hernandez.
Still to come, we are following new developments in the other murder case involving Aaron Hernandez.
On a warm day out there, temperatures near 80 degrees. We'll do it again tomorrow, but the weekend does promise a little rain, at least at the start. We'll talk about that coming up.
Whether it's having a few drinks or drinking a few too many, millions say they're alcoholics.
Alcohol addiction, or addiction in general, is a disease of the brain.
But is it possible for an alcoholic to ever drink socially?
Yes, not all problem drinkers, but many can.
It's controversial, but some say it can work. Why certain problem drinkers are stepping out of programs tonight at 10.
Cloudy over the city of Boston. Had some sun today out there, though. Still some sun outside the Fox 25 World Headquarters here in Dedham. Temperatures near 80 degrees. We'll do this all again tomorrow. I think there'll be some sun mixing with the clouds, and each day the threat of thunderstorms gets closer to us. So let's talk about this. Temperatures this evening, 70 in Boston, 67 in Worcester for your dinner plans. 60s out in Cape Cod, barely out at Chatham and Nantucket. Those sea breezes playing havoc there. And dew points have climbed. They're into the 60s, most locations, just a little less in southeastern Massachusetts, but that'll change. Everybody's dew points will be in the 60s tomorrow. It's time of year we have to talk about this, how sticky it's getting outside. You get the muggy air, get a little heating tomorrow from the sun, and you'll have to watch for those storms to start to pop up. A lot of clouds over us in the visible satellite picture right now. Off to the west, though, the thunderstorm threat has been just a few pop-ups in the Hudson Valley of New York. Not a big concern, but the heaviest stripe of rain from Toronto through western New York, Pennsylvania, southward, there's been some severe weather in the mid-Atlantic, and all the way down to off the coast of Florida. There have been some tornadoes or waterspouts spotted around Miami Beach, for instance. Now, all of that's trying to move eastward and getting kicked by this swirl in the atmosphere. This is going to come around behind the front and will play a part in our forecast Sunday and into early next week. So plenty to talk about here. First of all, tomorrow there'll be clouds and some sun. I think it's a little overdone as far as the shower activity tonight and into tomorrow morning. The general idea is most of the rain shower activity is going to be to the west of Worcester, in western Massachusetts, western New England, and points north from there. The heavy stuff is back in here, and that's going to eventually make its way on in here, but later Friday night and into Saturday morning. Spotty at first Friday night, more widespread Saturday morning. Tomorrow evening at Fenway Park, coming back home against those Detroit Tigers, 67 degrees at game time. There'll be a lot of clouds with some sunny breaks and the potential for a shower, but I think the risk is fairly low. And then that front comes across with the heavy rain Saturday morning. So here's your 7-day forecast. Takes you right through that weekend, which is going to start out wet Saturday, dry out Saturday afternoon. And then Sunday, there'll be a lot of clouds and it will be cooler and the threat of a shower. But for the most part, to me, it looks like it's going to stay dry. Mark?
Kevin, thank you. Mm-hmm. Today, two of the players in the Odin Lloyd murder investigation involving Aaron Hernandez were in court. Fox 25's Heather Hedges was there for both. And Heather, both of those suspects were facing a few charges tonight, new charges tonight. One is facing old health issues, right?
Yeah, in regards to the health issues, Ock, we learned that that may keep this co-defendant out of the courtroom for a while. The other co-defendant's lawyers question whether these upgraded charges are part of a legal strategy on the part of the state. That lawyer said these charges are beefed up, but the evidence hasn't changed. And he's wondering if this is the state's way of trying to make some of these alleged co-conspirators talk when they have been uncooperative in the past. We asked the state about that today, and they said, let's let the trial play out and the evidence speak for itself.
Not guilty.
Strong and decisive plea from Hernandez associate Ernest Wallace to upgraded charges of murder in the death of semi-pro football player Odin Lloyd. Wallace and another Hernandez associate, Carlos Ortiz, had previously pled not guilty to lesser charges of accessory to murder in the same case. But last month, the grand jury indicted Wallace on these charges of assaulting and beating Odin Lloyd with intent to murder him the night he was murdered last June in North Attleboro. Outside court, Wallace's defense attorney questioned state prosecutors' motives and said his client is looking forward to his day in court.
Timing of these new charges speaks for itself.
But if there are any ulterior motives with these new charges, a spokesman for the Bristol County DA's office is not talking about it and seemed to say the new charges should be looked at face value.
This has been a meticulously investigated case from day one. We've said it's been an ongoing investigation from day one. It's been 11 months. Evidence is presented to the grand jury, and the grand jury chooses to indict.
The family of Odin Lloyd was in court today, one family member wearing a pin with a picture of Lloyd. Also in the same courtroom, an attorney for Hernandez's cousin, Tanya Singleton, in Singleton's place. Singleton is currently under house arrest at the family's Lake Avenue home in Bristol, Connecticut. Her attorney explaining to the judge she remains there with her children fighting a new bout with breast cancer, which she's been dealing with since 2011.
She's had a turn for the worse with her health. Her cancer has recurred despite the efforts of her treating physician to prevent that from happening, and she really needs to concentrate on that. Right now.
Singleton was also indicted today by another grand jury in Suffolk County for refusing to testify about a double murder in Boston that Hernandez is also accused in. As for the Odin Lloyd murder trial, Singleton's attorney also brought up the possibility of trying Singleton with her accused co-conspirators, such as Wallace, as a way to move the case along. He said that would be Singleton's preference.
I think it makes sense. I think ultimately we're going to want to be tried with them.
And a lot happening here in Bristol County Court today. Aaron Hernandez's attorneys also filing motions in court today in the Odin Lloyd case. They are making motions to dismiss two charges against Aaron Hernandez, first-degree murder and unlawful possession of a firearm, saying the state doesn't have any forensic evidence linking Hernandez to the shooting death of Lloyd, and also the state doesn't have a motive. The state said they will respond in writing and would not respond to us. That's the latest live in Fall River outside Bristol County Court. I'm Heather Hedges, Fox 25 News.
I'm Fox 25 commentator Jim Polito. Governor Deval Patrick is preparing to leave on another taxpayer-funded international junket, his third in just 3 months. And when you add up the real cost of the governor traveling, it's like tens of millions of dollars. I'll explain why coming up.
Governor Patrick is getting ready to hop on a plane and go on another trade mission, something our commentator Jim Polito questions. Jim, explain.
All right, Ock. There's a big hidden cost in all of this travel, and I'll explain it here. This is the governor's third trip in just 7 months. He's only got 6 months left in office. He's headed to Israel and the United Arab Emirates on May 27th for a 9-day trip. The cost? $175,000. His office says some of the expenses will be picked up by taxpayers and some will be paid by businesses. Okay, in March, he traveled to Panama and Mexico at an estimated cost of $75,000 to $80,000. That's right. Last December, a Far East trip and a tab of $130,000. And a hop north of the border to Canada in October for $32,000. That brings us to a grand total of $412,000 just the past 6 or 7 months. Now, that's a lot of money, but it pales in comparison to the actual cost of these trips and the others he's taken actually over the past 8 years. Governor Deval Patrick has been an absentee manager of the Commonwealth, and even when he is here, it does not appear that he's engaged in the day-to-day management of his administration, never mind holding people accountable. So while the governor is out gallivanting or not paying attention to business, there's massive fraud within the EBT welfare system, tens of millions of dollars in waste. A rogue chemist causes drug dealers to be set free, setting taxpayers up for hundreds of millions of dollars in civil suits. More lawsuits over people killed by a compounding pharmacy that was not properly regulated by the state. Now, I could continue, but there are other things that do not have a dollar value. But they are so much more valuable, like a dead 5-year-old child, because of mismanagement at DCF. So what is the total cost? We don't know yet, but I'm sure it's a lot more than some airline tickets, restaurant, and hotel bills. What do you think? Tweet me, at Jim Polito.
All right, Jim, thank you. The FCC voting today to approve newly proposed rules that could lead to big changes for internet speeds and how much you pay. It's called net neutrality, and it could pave the way for internet providers to create new paid fast lanes on their networks. That would give them the opportunity to charge websites for faster speeds. The rules also call for stricter oversight of internet providers, similar to those applied to utility companies. The proposed rules will go into a 120-day public comment period. After that, the FCC will revise the proposal and vote on a final set of rules. Interesting topic. What do you think? Should people who use the internet the most pay for it? Results, myfoxboston.com web poll coming up at 6:30. But first, that's going to do it for the Fox 25 News at 6.
Fox 25 News at 6:30. That starts right now. You heard about it here first. Aaron Hernandez indicted on 2 more murder charges today. The expatriate now facing 3 in total. Good evening, everyone. I'm Mark Ackerman.
And I'm Maria Stefanos. Hernandez is accused of murdering now 2 Boston men in cold blood back in 2012. Our Ted Daniel kicks off our team coverage from our Beacon Hill studio. You broke it this morning, Ted. What do you have?
Maria, Mark, it's been a long time coming. Hernandez first became a suspect in the Boston drive-by after the murder of Odin Lloyd in North Attleboro last summer. Hernandez knew Lloyd, but in the Boston case, authorities say the victims were strangers gunned down after a chance encounter.
The 2012-2013 NFL season, one of the best for Aaron Hernandez, a new $40 million contract. 5 touchdowns. The former Patriot was living large right after authorities say he murdered Daniel Abreu and Safiro Furtado in cold blood.
Mr. De Abreu and Mr. Furtado were ambushed and executed as they drove home along Chaumont Avenue in Boston's South End.
Boston police detectives first connected Hernandez to the gangland-style drive-by in June 2013. And from there, the cold case got hot. Police found the murder weapon in a car linked to one of Hernandez's relatives. The SUV, witnesses say the shots came from, that was discovered hidden at the home of Hernandez's uncle in Bristol, Connecticut. Detectives examined surveillance video from in and around Cure Lounge, where Abreu, Furtado, and 3 friends had been partying. It allegedly shows Hernandez slowly circling the block in his SUV and then trailing the men as they left.
Our investigation has not uncovered any evidence that these several individuals were known to each other, but their chance encounter inside the club triggered a series of events that culminated in these murders.
Authorities will not say what happened during that chance encounter at the club or why Aaron Hernandez, a football star, would target strangers like a street thug.
All the time when we have shootings in the city, everyone right away thinks of gang activity. These were 2 young, innocent victims who I'm sure loved ones can never go on a day thinking about them.
Hernandez's cousin, Tanya Singleton, has also been indicted in connection with the case. Prosecutors say she refused to testify before the grand jury. This afternoon, lawyers for Hernandez released a statement. It says it's one thing to make allegations at a press conference and another thing to prove them in a courtroom. Hernandez looks forward to his day in court, according to his attorneys. Hernandez will likely face trial for the Lloyd murder in Bristol County before he's brought to Boston to face charges here. I'm Ted Daniel, Fox 25 News.
Ted, thank you. Meantime, the fathers of Furtado and Abreu going before the media tonight, sharing their reaction to Hernandez's indictment. Their attorney spoke on their behalf.
I think what is important to both of these fathers is that they were very proud of their sons. They cared about their sons. Their sons were special people, and they had a whole world in front of them that was taken away from them. But in a sense, you might say, I guess, obviously they're victims too. They lost a loved one, a son, a brother, somebody who looked after his nieces and other people in the family.
These families have been waiting for nearly 2 years for charges to be brought against the suspect in the murder of their loved ones.
Fox 25, the only station to speak with an eyewitness to the murders who identified Aaron Hernandez as the killer. He's a man who was there that night and who first told his story to Fox Undercover's Mike Beaudet last year. Mike is back with a look at that interview that actually foreshadowed today's developments, Mike.
This is a chilling story, an eyewitness account we first brought you last year. The man who was in the car with the murder victims told us Aaron Hernandez pulled the trigger, and now District Attorney Dan Connolly agrees.
These indictments reflect shots fired at three surviving victims who were in the automobile with Mr. Abreu and Mr. Furtado. Those victims are one man who was struck but not killed.
The man struck but not killed is this man, a man who showed Fox Undercover his bullet scars last year and told us months ago what District Attorney Dan Connolly is now confirming, that Aaron Hernandez allegedly killed two of his good friends after a night out at Cure Lounge in Boston's Theater District. He didn't want us showing his face or saying his name, but the man's words are as powerful now as they were then. They just came up and started firing for no reason at all. D.A. Connolly now says Hernandez and another person entered the club at the same time as the victims, and there was some sort of chance encounter inside, triggering a series of events that culminated in the murders. The shooting survivor told us last year, "We never had any trouble. We were not those kind of people. We were just having fun." They left at 2 a.m. when the club closed. The five men were on their way home, stopped here at a red light on Chaminade Ave, about to turn left. The shooting survivor says suddenly an SUV pulled up beside them. He says he heard someone shout, "What up, Negroes?" and then the bullets started flying. Danny was driving. Safira was in the passenger seat. The shooting survivor was in the back seat, right in the middle of his other two friends. Things happened so fast, I was trying to defend myself. They were shooting everywhere inside the car, front to back. They just came to kill. That's it. It wasn't until after Hernandez was arrested for the murder of Odin Lloyd that this man made the connection. He's never been a football fan, but he recognized Hernandez's face. When I see his face, I just recognize his face. Compare his face that night to his face now. It's that face that I remember. Last year, the witness told me he didn't understand why it was taking so long for Aaron Hernandez to be charged with the murders. Now, after Hernandez has been indicted, he's declining to talk about the developments. I'm Mike Beaudet for Fox Undercover.
And remember to stay with Fox 25 on air and on myfoxboston.com for the very latest on the new indictments handed up today against former New England Patriot Aaron Hernandez. In other news, then to Salisbury now, where a man wielding a machete was shot and killed today after he attacked two people. Fox 25's Jared Holbrook joins us now with the story. And Jared, what happened here?
Well, the man with the machete was shot and killed by police today. The call came in at 1 o'clock this afternoon to police as a domestic incident involving a knife. A 29-year-old man apparently attacked two people with a machete, a man and a woman, and police responded right away, and they didn't have to go far. I'm standing right next to the police department. Right down the road, about three blocks, is where it happened. Now, when responding, the man deliberately rammed his car into a police cruiser. That's the crash that you see. Now, the man got out with a knife and a machete. Police ordered him to stop and to put his weapons down, and then a taser was used to subdue him. It's unclear at this point if that taser fire was successful or not. That is something they are looking into. The man then charged at police, and police shot and killed him. Now, witnesses tell us that they heard 3 to 4 rapid-fire shots. It's unclear how many shots exactly were fired by police. We just spoke with the district attorney not long ago. Here's what he had to say.
29-year-old male exited the vehicle armed with a knife and with a machete. Multiple attempts were made by the police on the scene to disarm the male, including the use of a taser.
The victims, a male and a female, are in serious condition in the hospital. One of them had to be taken to the hospital by helicopter. So we'll keep you up to date on that. State police are investigating. This is standard procedure when an officer is involved in a shooting. We're live in Salisbury tonight. I'm Jared Holbrook, Fox 25 News.
All right, Jared, thank you. We are following breaking news out of Haverhill at this hour. This massive apartment complex fire earlier this month was caused by improper disposal of smoking materials. The fire causing hundreds and thousands of dollars worth of damage, but the big story that came out of this whole thing is that mother had to jump from a third-story balcony with her 18-month-old son in her arms to escape the flames. Well, Christina Samoas broke her back during that fall. Her little boy escaped with barely a scratch. Doctors say that they're not sure if Samoas will walk again, but she is feeling some things in her legs. New details coming out in court today about the suspected marathon bomber's testimony in court showing the Sarnaev brothers had big plans, apparently, for their future. In a suppression hearing in Boston federal court, a federal agent said Jahar's friend, D.S. Karabayev, told investigators, that's actually Ernest Wallace, and I don't know why we're showing that. So let's get that, let's do that, and let's go back to me. Okay, this is what happened here with the Sarnaev stuff. Jahar had told Diaz that he and Tamerlan planned on opening up a Starbucks or an Apple store together in Kazakhstan. The agent went on to say that Karabayev asked about joining the FBI and jokingly made references about smoking marijuana during questioning after his arrest. Karabayev and two other friends came to the attention of law enforcement because Jahar texted them after the bombings, even alluding to his alleged involvement in those texts. Diaz writes, "You saw the news?" Jahar replies, "Yeah, bro, I did." Diaz, "For real?" Jahar, "I saw the news. Better not text me, my friend. LOL. Diaz, you saw yourself in there? Ha, 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 ha. Jahar, if you want to go to my room, you can take what's there. But all right, bro. Salam alaikum, which means peace unto you. Diaz, what's wrong with you? Ha, ha. Jahar, can't right now, man." The judge at today's hearing refused to suppress statements Karabayev and Azamat Tazayakov allegedly made to investigators during their arrests.
Still ahead, the tears were contagious today in New York City as the President of the United States officially opened the 9/11 Museum.
Clouds overhead, but mild and muggy outside. More of this tomorrow. And how about that weekend? That forecast straight ahead.
First on Fox.
Aaron Hernandez now stands officially indicted in that Boston double murder.
First on Twitter. Fox 25, breaking new developments in the Aaron Hernandez murder investigation every step of the way.
We first reported back last summer. Investigators began looking at Hernandez.
Fox 25 News.
Warm temperatures out there. Some towns getting into the 80s. Had some reports coming in from all of your weather spotters. Here they are. WeatherMyFoxBoston.com is a place you want to set up if you want to get in on the act. Spencer joins the list at 78 degrees. Hooksett and Pepperell both coming in at 80 plus. Nice. So temperatures in the 70s to around 80 degrees. Today it is 70 right now in Boston. The dew point's a sticky 61, though. So if you're going out this evening and haven't been out all day, be aware. It is kind of sticky outside. It's going to get worse as the night goes on and certainly during the day tomorrow. It's a little less humid in southeastern Massachusetts, but it's still mild, 69 in Plymouth. It gets cooler when you get out to the Cape, Chatham, and Nantucket. But out there, the dew points have been in the upper 50s this afternoon, even some lower 50s out here at Nantucket and Chatham. But it is stickier back in here. And all this air is taking over New England for a day tomorrow. Now, there are a lot of clouds out there, I realize. Some breaks, some sun once in a while. A little more sun out toward the islands right now in the Outer Cape. But it's this line of showers and storms that's going to be approaching us this weekend. You can see a few of those make it into New England tomorrow. I think western New England most likely, but we'll watch for a few to escape some rogue showers for central and eastern New England. But those showers and thunderstorms will be here Saturday. And then there's this swirl in the atmosphere. It's going to dominate our weather Sunday and into early next week. That's a cold pool in the upper atmosphere. It's one of those situations you get some sun, it produces clouds.
clouds and a couple random showers. Won't be wet for everyone, though. So first overnight, a couple showers showing up on the computer models here. I just think it's picking up on the increased humidity. I don't expect showers later tonight or first thing in the morning. Now, tomorrow afternoon, a few of those showers and thunderstorms, western New England especially, start to pop up. Again, we'll have to watch for a couple of rogue showers to make it farther east. But it's the heavy stuff back here. It's going to get here early Saturday morning as this whole system approaches us. Heaviest rain looks to be around sunrise Saturday, but it also looks like it's going to get out of here by lunchtime Saturday. So in the afternoon, things should be drying out across New England, and that gets on out of here. Now watch Sunday afternoon. We'll start the day with mostly sunny skies, but as the day goes on, those clouds and the showers start to build up. Again, overdone here, but you get the idea that there'll be the risk for some showers Sunday afternoon. Same deal in the 7 day from Monday, Tuesday, and even into Wednesday with that same system affecting. I think it starts to pull away by Thursday, and we'll start to warm up with more sunshine in the forecast as well. But generally, that system is going to dominate our weather Sunday and through early next week with the risk of a shower just about every afternoon. But not everyone's going to get wet. The wettest time for all looks to be Saturday morning. Maria?
All right, Kevin, thank you. They are gone, never forgotten. Artifacts documenting the lives of those lost in the 9/11 attacks and the events of the deadly day now on display 70 feet beneath Ground Zero in Lower Manhattan. Fox's Brian Lanas is in New York with more.
It's a day of sadness, honor, and perseverance as 9/11 survivors and victims' family members come together to remember what happened here nearly 13 years ago. Beneath the footprints of the Twin Towers is a collection of artifacts celebrating the lives of those lost and recounting the horror of that day. The Underground Museum at Ground Zero, opening more than a decade after nearly 3,000 were murdered in the attacks. President Obama visiting Lower Manhattan for a dedication ceremony.
Here, we tell their story so that generations yet unborn will never forget.
The event, a relatively small gathering of family members, survivors, and first responders. They are among those with exclusive access to the exhibits before they open to the public next week.
The Great Wall and bedrock that embrace us today, nothing can ever break us.
Two trident-shaped pieces of the tower stand at the entrance of the facility. When looking up at them, you can see One World Trade Center, America's tallest building. Visitors then travel seven stories below ground, where they're met with reminders of the human and structural cost of the attacks. Twisted metal, damaged emergency vehicles, dust-covered jeans, even shoes. Attacks on the Pentagon and Flight 93 are also included in the museum. The 1993 World Trade Center bombing is included as well. In New York, Brian Yenis, Fox News.
All right, let's go to California now, where those wildfires continue to spread. In all, nine fires are now burning in San Diego County. The fire coming dangerously close to buildings. In fact, a local college had to cancel afternoon classes because of all the smoke. Crews forced to fly in water in an effort to try to contain these flames. The fire started on Tuesday, has since spread to thousands of acres.
Honoring our heroes, two monuments will be rededicated to war veterans tomorrow, but the state needs your help to make this happen. And here to explain is State Representative Sheila Harrington. Representative, nice to see you tonight.
Nice to see you too, Mark.
Tell us more about these memorials and where they'll be rededicated.
Well, the memorials are actually two specific memorials. This year is the 70th anniversary of the Battle of the Bulge, and there is a memorial at the Winchendon Veterans Cemetery, the Massachusetts Veterans Cemetery in Winchendon, Massachusetts. These monuments were actually paid for and basically put there by some Battle of the Bulge veterans and some Central Massachusetts veterans a few years back.
Why are the monuments being rededicated?
Well, as I said, this is in fact the 70th anniversary of the Battle of the Bulge. And when these monuments were originally dedicated, there was very little recognition among, as far as these veterans felt, among people in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And last fall, as I often have the honor to work with veterans, it was Veterans Day, at a Veterans Day event, and I was advised by one of these Battle of the Bulge veterans that they really needed my help and they would like me to come out and see this memorial and tell me a little bit about what went on. And so I did. Around Thanksgiving time, I met with this veteran again, Joseph Landry from Shirley, Massachusetts, and along with Representative Jen Benson and Representative John Zlotnick, we went out and we met a remarkable gentleman by the name of Christian DeMarkin from Central Massachusetts, and he really has been probably the most instrumental in making things happen to remember the Wareth 11.
I was going to say, explain the importance of remembering our veterans in these kinds of memorials, and we have Memorial Day coming up in the not-too-distant future as well.
Right. Well, I think it's always imperative that we keep their memory alive, but this particular memorial has different meaning. Back in the 1940s, we had a very segregated military, and toward the end of the Battle of the Bulge, 11 African American members from the 333rd Field Artillery Battalion sought some refuge at a small town called Wareth, Belgium. They were sort of ratted out by somebody in the community, and then they were taken and really brutally, and I mean brutally tortured by the German SS, and left in the field, killed and left in the fields of Wareth, Belgium. So in fact, it was the people of Wareth, Belgium that first put up a memorial to these 11 African Americans. They were just, their families were told they died in combat, nothing was ever done, and you know, it was around the holiday time, and the words peace on earth, goodwill to men kept, you know, playing, and I thought, they went over there to fight for our country. They went over there to fight for peace on earth, but sure. Even in their final moments, they left so that the Langier family that had given them shelter would not be hurt, and they volunteered to go out to the SS, knowing probably very well what fate would then become them.
Clearly, the public can help out by attending this dedication, these rededications tomorrow. But what about veterans who may want to participate? How can they get in touch with folks tonight to find out where they should be and when?
Well, where they should be and when would be the Massachusetts Veterans Cemetery in Winchendon, Massachusetts at 2 p.m. We have tried to supply transportation for people that have let us know that they needed it. But I would also say that they should talk to their veterans service agents. And if they do have a concern and they would like to see if we can help them find a way out there tomorrow morning, I would recommend that they call 978-448-9601. And most importantly, their veteran service agent can also probably direct them to someone who can give them transportation. In fact, the Secretary of Veterans Affairs Office, Secretary Coleman Nee, has offered to try to help get people transportation.
Very good. Gonna have to leave it at that, but we will put this on our website, myfoxboston.com, for those veterans need to know that phone number again. State Representative Sheila Harrington of Groton, we appreciate your time tonight.
Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you.
Fox Feedback now. Today, the FCC voted to approve proposed net neutrality rules. Some say it could lead us to paying for the internet the same way that we pay for utilities like electricity. So we asked you, should people who use the internet the most pay for it? A lot of you like this question, and you voted on our poll, and most of you, you don't like this idea at all. 15% of you said yes, 85% of you said no, everybody should pay the same. We always appreciate your feedback.
Tonight, Something Good is all about bringing a child's fantasy to life. Details next. You're watching Fox 25 News at 6:30. Red Sox in action this afternoon. Let's pick it up top of the ninth. Bases loaded. Sox trailing 3-1, but Will Middlebrooks comes up with the two-run single to right here. Ties the game at 3 apiece as we slide across safely. We go to the bottom of the 10th, though. Extra innings. Aaron Hicks coming up with a flare right here to left, and Kurt Suzuki on his horse going to beat the throw home, and the Twins win it by a final score of 4-3. By the way, that's the Twins' second walk-off win against the Sox this series. Sox come home, though, for a six-game homestand. Detroit, Toronto, up next, starting tomorrow.
Finally, it's our Something Good. The new Legoland Discovery Center in Somerville is getting ready to open up next week, and we have a sneak peek for you inside. Take a look. It spans 44,000 square feet. Features a whole bunch of attractions, including factory tours, rides, even a 4D theater. Just so you know, adults are not allowed inside the center unless they're accompanied by a child. However, adult nights will be held every once in a while. I like that.
A sign guy is an expert Lego builder. You should know that about him.
He is?
He absolutely is. Yeah.
I didn't know.
There you go. 7-day forecast includes another day tomorrow like today, kind of muggy, and some rain to start Saturday, but better by the afternoon. See you tonight at 10.
And 11. Thanks for being with us, everybody.
Next, Jeansy, hot celeb on the beach, acting really thirsty.
Isn't it less attractive?
No, it almost makes it more hot that she's desperate.
Next on Fox 25.